We know we have more work to do on it. We're looking forward to some of the innovations you've shown us and how we can bring those into our portal as we do future releases. But it's been an excellent experience. So thank you very much. We look forward to working with you. Thanks for doing excellent.
So yeah, I mean, you know, I would like to summarize by saying, you know, when you talk about a smart city, it's about, I think it's about its citizens, it's about its business, how the government can put in place very efficient processes, help its citizens participate in governance, and look at what it's delivering to its citizens on a regular basis, and improve services and make it sustainable. So those are the key things that I wanted to touch upon in my summary at the end. Thank you very much for your time.
Good morning, everyone. So thank you so much for coming here this morning, and especially being here at the start of my work at Microsoft. I get to visit a lot of institutions, academic institutions. And it's always a pleasure coming, visiting and talking to younger generations, because that's where the field of innovation is happening today. Yeah? I'm sure a lot of you have some idea in mind, and you never know, which is the idea that's probably going to be given in the future. The reason I say this is, when I visit any of the institutions, at least I find 5-6 students who probably have a very unique idea that they want to do in the field of IT. And I think today in India, we live in the world where the buzzword is startups, right? That means students or any other generation starting their own company, we call them entrepreneurs, right? So how many of you are entrepreneurs today? Or how many of you want to be entrepreneurs? Come on. You've got to show some energy. If you're saying, I want to, how many of you want to have your own company? Let me put it that way.
Nobody.
You guys are, all of you are awake, right? Yeah? Had you breakfast? Yeah? Okay, now, how many of you want to have your own company in the future? That means you're your own boss. Come on. You guys are still sleeping. That's fine, no problem. Let's get started. How many of you use Facebook here, by the way? How many of you are on Facebook? Yeah, see, that is my answer. Yeah? So, Facebook. So, all of you on Facebook? So, what do you use? Use a smartphone, computer. What do you use to access Facebook? Laptop? How many of you have smartphones? Yeah? You can show it, that's fine. It's absolutely fine. Some of you are just waking up in a half hand, some of you 3-4 hand. Go ahead. So should I assume that 80% of you have smartphones here? Yeah? Wonderful. Now, Facebook is an app that you use. It's an app. You understand an app, correct? You install Angry Birds. Have you played Angry Birds? Okay, wonderful. See, this is now you kind of, you seem to be awake now. How many said Angry Birds? Okay? Even I love Angry Birds. Now, let me take you from my previous speaker who spoke really well. And see, we live in the world of consumers. Everything that we are doing is Microsoft. Any company doesn't matter. Everything revolves around consumers. We're the consumers, right? If you're using a smartphone, if you're using an app to access internet or access your friends and colleagues in a different world, it's all about technologies surrounding you as an individual, right? So some of the terms that we heard in the previous session, cloud computing, yeah? Now, we definitely live in a world of mobile devices. If you look at it, in 2009, this is a stat you should remember, 2009, number of devices on this planet, yeah, increased the number of people on this planet. You've got 6 billion people on this planet. 6 billion, right? You guys should tell us, you're all students. 6 billion? Okay. 6 billion students on this planet, not students, people on this planet. Now, number of devices today are probably 10 billion, 11 billion, 12 billion. By 2020, the stat says it will be 50 billion, right? See, many of you have your laptop computer, you have your phones, right? It's more than one device. If you look at, if you go to a petrol station, there might be a processor running in the petrol tank which says, you know what, right now the inventory in the tank is 20%, hence it has to be refueled. You go to the ATM, what is running there is this operating system which is helping you withdraw, you know, money, right? All those are devices, right? And you walk into a movie theater, let's say you walk an amusement park, at the entrance there is a system which says verify your ticket. Airport, they actually scan your boarding pass, right? There's an operating system running there as well. They're all connected devices. So when I say 20 or 50 billion devices in 2020, it includes all those devices. So today we live in a world of connected devices. You don't feel like, you probably feel, I don't know, this is my experience. I've been here yesterday, and I'm slightly feeling fish out of water because I don't have internet. Yeah? All of you have actually internet in this island, correct? To some extent, yeah? How many of you don't have internet? All of you have internet, right? I don't want to force you to say no. I mean, all of you have internet. Now, I feel fish out of water for the simple reason that we used to live in a connected world, and that's where action happens. The moment you get distracted, you see me on a holiday. So from yesterday, I feel I'm on a holiday. And honestly, you know, being coming to the island, it has to be a holiday. I'm definitely going to come back sometime future with family and something like that. Now, cloud, right? So this, I said Facebook, right? So Facebook is installed as an app on your mobile devices or a laptop, correct? In the laptop, you use a browser, right? Now it connects to information in the backend, right? You can assume that to be a cloud, right? Why do you call it cloud? It's there somewhere. The server is running somewhere, and it's hosted by somebody else, and it can be a private cloud. That means in the island, you might have your own data center. You might call it as a private cloud, or it might be somewhere else in a different part of the world. Somebody is hosting this, you can call it as a public cloud. For example, it can be Oracle, Microsoft, Google, all these companies, we have our own public cloud offering. That means we give you infrastructure. End of the day, today in the world, number of connected devices increasing, number of devices that you are buying is increasing. Hence, you won't be able to buy servers and put it in your, you know, real estate premise. It's difficult. Hence, public cloud vendors like us are giving you space in terms of unlimited compute. You want 20 servers, 100 servers, 1,000 servers, it's available. Okay? I wanted to set clarity on that part. As Microsoft, yes, you know, one of the areas that we absolutely want to take a step forward is in terms of offering new experiences. Yeah? All of you use Windows operating system here? Yeah? Windows 7?
8.
Windows 8, 8.1, wonderful, good to hear that. Now, end of this month, which is June 29th, we're officially launching Windows 10. Okay? I'm here to talk about Windows 10. I'm going to show you a few slides in terms of preview, but mostly to talk about experiences. Because going forward, the version number of Windows becomes irrelevant. You would not have 11, 12, 13. This is the last version you're going to make. Because going forward, this is going to be the biggest service to this planet in terms of offering the operating system. So anything that's going to happen on your missions, because Windows runs everywhere, it is going to be one operating system going forward. Today, if you look at it, we have, how many people use Windows Phone? I'm just curious. On back, 20 people, that's fine. Good. How many of you use iPhones here? How many of you use Android? Majority. Wonderful. Now, Windows is going to be the single largest service available going forward. What the service means, you install Windows 10 when it gets announced end of this month, 29. After that, you're going to get a free upgrade to Windows 8, 8.1, Windows 10. All of you are going to get a free upgrade to Windows 10. After Windows 10 sits on your machine, you would not see any further versions coming in. On a regular basis, the operating system would get upgraded. Okay? So as Microsoft, we have multiple service offerings, multiple form factors. These are form factors. I am using one form factor, which is laptop. You have one form factor for a smartphone. At home, it can be TV. That's also a form factor. So we have offerings just from a Windows standpoint, that's everywhere. Okay? I'll show you what that means in a little while from now. But at the end of the day, it is about, as a company, we want to help you achieve more. Our vision is to enable every individual, every organization on this planet to achieve more. Yeah? It's about experiences. I'll show this picture, which basically some slides are getting dark, so bear with me. That's a Windows 10 logo at the top. But this is the range that we're talking about in terms of Windows going forward. Now, starting from, I mean, all of you are engineering, you know, you're doing engineering discipline, I guess, right? All of you are engineering, all of you are engineering, correct? How many of you are electronic, electrical, electronic, mechanical? Yeah. Computer science? Okay. Now, if you look at it, if you take a device which doesn't have any head, what does it mean? That means it doesn't have any user experience to it. It can be, let's say, as I said, it can be a scanning mission at the airport. There's no user interface there. You don't see the screens. You just scan. It tells you whether you're a valid traveler or not, and accordingly, they let you in, right? That is a headless system, basically. Right from that till the largest screen, which is a 72-inch PPI, perspective pixel interface board, we have the same operating system running, right? That means from a headless device, to the smartphone, to the laptop, to the tablet, to HoloLens. I'm not sure how many of you heard HoloLens. HoloLens? You heard HoloLens? You can probably raise your hand a little, you know, straight so that I can see it. One person. I'll show you a video very soon in terms of what HoloLens is all about. How many of you have heard Google Glass? A few of you. Now, this is the nature that you understand where I'm heading towards in terms of the experience. Now, going forward, it's going to be one converged platform. What is a platform? Platform is basically a technology blueprint where you build solutions. It can be apps. Just curious, as part of your academic curriculum, how many of you build software? How many of you build apps? Apps? Applications? Solutions? Nobody? Android? That doesn't matter. I'm not saying Windows. I'm generally saying any platform. It can be Unix. It can be any form of Linux, which is Ubuntu, CentOS, whatever it is. How many of you have built solutions, softwares? Show of hands. As part of engineering curriculum, I'm sure you're building softwares, right? No? How many of you built an Android app? Okay. Very less number of folks. Nobody. I think just to give you the perspective, when you talk about connected devices, when you talk about platforms, that's where the majority of the world is today, in terms of helping you people, helping every individual to be productive. Yeah? For example, if you want to go to a movie, you don't want to go to theaters and then you buy tickets, right? I mean, I'm sure that's the case here, but generally in a crowded place, let's say Bangalore for that matter, going to the theater itself takes 2 hours. A movie might be 1 hour duration. It doesn't make sense to travel 2 hours. So at home, you use an app, book a ticket, and go to the theater, right? That's where the convenience factor comes into picture. Now, coming to Converge platform, I'm going to show new experience which we announced last month. Yeah? We officially demonstrated this particular experience for one of the conferences, for Build Conference. But this is the HoloLens. As I said, our vision is to enable new experience to consumers. And what you can see is something called a HoloLens, which was announced a month back. And again, this is something which will probably, it's future for sure, but it's real today. Yeah, it's real today. It's going to be made public very soon in terms of people who can buy these lenses. This is, I would say, the heights of innovation at Microsoft today. I would not be surprised once to go public, every individual probably making a step forward to buy this device, because this is about their experiences. Again, what is running inside that is Windows. Let's take a look at this video so you understand what is HoloLens and what is possible going forward. It's about innovations actually complemented by what can be real in the future, right? Let's take a look at that video.
Look around. Technology is all around us. We use it in every aspect of our lives. It enables us to do amazing things. But what if we could go further? What if you could go beyond the screen? Where your digital world is blended with your real world. Now we can. This is the world of holograms. What will they enable us to do? New ways to visualize our work.
I have an idea for the fuel tank.
new ways to share ideas with each other.
How things are you?
I just took the images in one room. More immersive ways to play. New ways to teach and learn.
So put the new trap in the place of the old one.
No.
And tighten here and here.
New ways to collaborate and explore places we've never been.
Look at this formation.
Let's take a closer look.
And new ways to create the thing we imagine. Because when you change the way you see the world, you can change the world you see.
So if you're building a solution today, if you're building an app today, it absolutely runs. I mean, you can actually access the app using HoloLens. It's nothing but a platform which is helping you build apps that's accessible through HoloLens that you're wearing there. Yeah? I mean, all of us want to buy bigger screen TVs in our houses, right? Now, many times it can be the wall that is not apt in terms of putting stuff, or it can be price which is too expensive. But with HoloLens, you can design your own screen size by watching any of these movies, etc. That's the beauty. And recently, when NASA, I think last 2 weeks back or so, one of the space shuttle, not space shuttle, something said sending something to space and that crashed midair, right? Yes. So they're actually carrying two HoloLens also with them because they wanted to enable, make it real in the space in terms of how instructions given from Earth and how they can instruct people in space, similar to how you saw the gentleman instructed the lady to fix the tap at the bottom of the sink. Yeah? So those experiences are very real today. Moving on, this is very high. Let me just take a minute to talk about application platforms. If you're building a software today, if you're building an app today, it can be any app, okay? JetAdis, or it can be BookMyShow, it can be what is the most popular app that you guys use here? Is there any local app that you use? Which is what? Share it. So can it be a cloud?
Share it, sir.
Share it. Okay, is that a popular app here? Share it? WhatsApp. How many of you use WhatsApp here? Gosh, I should have asked that question before. What did I say Facebook? So WhatsApp is the only thing today. Now, WhatsApp is an app. Okay, it sits on your device. It can be, if it's a browser, also a web version, but otherwise, if it's an Android, iOS, Windows Phone, it's an app sitting there. And somebody has to build that app, right? It's pure programming there. Now, if you look at Windows, I'm trying to paint a picture of where we are coming together today, okay? At the end, what you see is Windows 10. But today, as I speak, we have multiple platforms available to build an app. If it's a Windows Phone app, have to know Windows Phone programming. If it's a Windows 8 or 8.1 or 7 operating system, I have to have different skills in terms of building an app. And Xbox, how many of you have heard of Xbox? Good. PlayStation? Okay. Now there's a good number of people who know both. Now, end of the day, we have different. So, Xbox is a gaming platform. So, for example, if I want to play a racing game or a football game in my living room or entertainment room, I can absolutely play that using Xbox. It's a gaming platform. So they also want access to Windows. Now, if you want to build your own game for Xbox, it is a different platform to build an app. Going forward, I think it's true today, we've converged all platforms. It's going to be one platform called Windows. Okay? We call it Universal Windows Platform. You don't have to build twice. Yeah? Going back to the earlier saying, I think it's true with Java, where they said, build once, run anywhere. That was the philosophy there. So, it's true with Windows today. You can build one app, which morphs itself into the form factor of your choice. So if you're building an app, you're going to build only once. If you open the same app in a Windows phone, it's going to conform the form factor of the Windows phone. If you open that on a large screen TV, automatically it's going to scale out. Yeah? So going forward, in terms of building an app, it's going to be very, very simple. With simple programming languages, how many of you know C# programming languages? .NET? .NET? Yeah. Two people. What language do you learn as part of your academic curriculum? C++?
Yes.
Java? How many people know C++? Java? Okay. Wonderful. Now, going forward, if you know one language called C#, which is Java-like, C++-like, so if you know the language, absolutely can build one app which runs across all devices. When I say all devices, Windows 8, I would say Windows 10, which runs everywhere, Android, iOS, all the devices in one shot. Okay? Now, I'm not sure how many of you see Windows 10. This is what it's meant in terms of, in terms of how the app will morph itself into multiple form factors. You see three form factors there, right? One is a phone, second is a tablet, and third is a large screen TV. I would say it can be big monitors, right? And you put one app, automatically the same app will scale with the resolution, with the form factor. See, one of the challenges we have is Windows is we give you multiple resolutions. When you change resolutions, you don't have one resolution which typically is dominant in iOS and Android world. You need multiple resolutions because my comfort in terms of how I personalize my operating system. So an app that we build has to scale up as resolutions and form factors. This is what I meant by one converged platform. So we call it universal apps. So it can be devices, IoT is a term my friend earlier spoke, Internet of Things, and those are the connected systems they spoke about, or mobile PC, Xbox, Surface Hub. Surface Hub is one of the devices we announced sometime back, which basically is meant for conference rooms. Yeah? Imagine your large flat screen, your conference room, you can interact with your fellow colleagues, somewhere else out in the world. How many of you have heard of Skype? Skype, yeah, many of you. So Skype is our product, right? So Skype, using Skype, you can actually connect to millions of people across wherever they are in the world. Now, all of you, if you using Windows, I'm sure you use Office, right? Word, Excel, PowerPoint, right? All of those are apps, by the way. Yeah, they're all desktop apps. And going forward, with our one platform story, you're going to have one store, okay? Be it a Windows Phone, Windows 8, Windows 8.1, Windows 10, Xbox, HoloLens, Microsoft Bank, it's all going to be one converged store. In whichever form factor you open that particular store app, it will show only apps within that particular store. Okay? So Office is also an app which will be delivered to you as a software from the store. Irrespective of whether it's Android, iOS, or Windows, you're going to have Office available. Today, Office is available on Android as well, right? So if you have an Android tablet or iPad or Windows, you have Office everywhere available. Now, this is what I spoke about, one store. You understand store, right? Because in the future, if you install a WhatsApp on your device, you have to get it from the store, App Store, or a Google Play Store, or a Windows Store. Yeah? Okay. Any questions so far? You guys have been really quiet. You could understand what I'm saying, right?
Yes, sir.
Oh, you guys are waiting now. Yeah. I'll move a bit fast here. Now, what comes with Windows 10 is a new browser called Microsoft Edge. Okay? Why new browser? Because we feel experiences are changing. The expectations from consumers are, I would say multiplying on a regular basis. We expose new touch form factors. I think all of us don't want to use a form factor which is non-touch, right? My laptop is a touch laptop. You might you might buy a tablet or a handheld device which has touch interface. So natural user interface, we call it NUI. Natural user interface is something which is desirable for consumers. Hence, the browser also has to respond to your touch interfaces. Now, we have a browser called Edge. It's from X of Edge. Now, that's something which will respond to your touch gestures. And you can annotate. It's called web annotation. For example, if you might be reading a news article in your browser. Now, you might want to highlight, annotate, and send it to your friends and family saying, hey, you know what, interesting article. Today, the way to do that is to basically do a print screen, copy it somewhere else, annotate, and then save it and send it to somebody else. But going forward, Edge will let you annotate and do web. Yeah? And also, most websites that you visit today, it's basically very, very cluttered, right? Ads dominate content. You agree with me on that? Ads on the site, if you go to timesofcanada.com, I hope nobody's there in Times of India here. If you go to timesofcanada.com, content will be probably 10 lines, but ads will be 100, all around that. GDP goes down, right? You feel very uncomfortable, or rather, where is the content here to read? Now, in those scenarios, you might want a reading view. So, Microsoft Edge gives you a reading view which only shows content, takes off all the other distractions to that. Okay, that's Edge for you. Now, Cortana. How many of you heard of Cortana? One. Okay, one person. How many of you heard of Siri? Six? One. Okay. That makes me happy, just one on one. Yeah? Okay. Now, they're called personal digital assistant. Right? So if you take a phone and you can speak to the phone, saying, hey, the book me tickets for this movie in so-and-so theater. And that assistant takes that instructions from you and does the job for you. Yeah? That's your assistant. For example, you want to set reminders, hey, I have a meeting with so-and-so person tomorrow. Can you set the meeting in the calendar, Cortana, and she will do it for you. Yeah? So Cortana is a critical part of Windows 8.1 phone time. Yeah? It came with the phone. Now we're making Cortana omnipresent. Take any device which is Windows, you'll have Cortana built into that particular operating system. I have Cortana on my laptop as well. Right? I can absolutely instructions. I don't have internet access here. I was asked to bring it, but I said no. But if internet access is given my laptop, I can say, hey Cortana, can you check what time is the flight back to Bangalore? She will respond back by looking at my calendar, all through my email. She'll be ready with access. Right? In fact, this morning she reminded me that, hey, Sandeep, you have a meeting at Ambitious Technology at 10 o'clock. So she, when you wake up, for example, you want to say, hey, set alarm for me tomorrow 6 a.m. Right? Typically, you go to alarm app in your phone and you set alarm and all the stuff, right? But she will do that for you. Going forward, Cortana is going to be an integral part of Windows. Any device, phone, tablet, Xbox, band, HoloLens, Cortana is going to build it. This is how it is, basically, right? So if you look at that screenshot there, I just managed to put a screenshot, but otherwise, the instructions and your Windows 7 or 8.18 has built-in search, right? It has search. It searches local machine or it searches the web, right? Now, going forward, Cortana will be the default search assistant for you. She will search locally as with the internet and give you information. Okay? So a few glimpses of building in what is applicability of the operating system in manufacturing any other world for that matter, right? As I said, moment you say Windows, generally people think, hey, it is desktop, it is phone. No, I think Windows desktop is probably, I would say two of the 10 things that Windows runs on. Yeah, walk in ATM, Windows is running there as well. Okay? Now, let's take a few examples. It can be consumer commercial devices, or for example, as part of your academic curriculum, if you're building, if you want to build something, if you think, let's say, Intel Galileo chip, or Raspberry Pi, you heard of these two? Intel Galileo chip, or Raspberry Pi, you should have heard this, right? So if you take Galileo or Raspberry Pi, Windows runs on those chips, right? Let me take you through a few examples. By the way, you should know this, in Windows, Inking is a very, very critical part. It's called the direct ink support. Earlier, with Windows 7, Windows 8, I think with Windows 8, we had an abstraction on, you know, inking capability. But going forward, with Windows 10, direct ink is native. That means nobody has done this so far. It is close to writing on any paper. Because at time you start writing on a tablet. See, when you write on a tablet, how do you write? You basically, you know, rest your this part of the palm, right? On the glass, and then you write. Now, when you do that, many of the operating systems today recognize that as a touch. But in writing, that is not touch. All that should take is the edge of your pen, correct? So all the stuff is here today. Take any form factors of Windows, you would definitely have inking capability out of the box, as long as it's a touch-based interface. So 2-in-1 tablets. I think this is something which has already become popular in terms of, hey, I have a laptop, but you know what? I don't like the keyboard at times because I'm probably sitting at ease. I want to stretch my legs and I want to hold my tablet, a screen only, and watch a movie. You can detach a keyboard. Those are different devices, right? So you don't want a keyboard to knock off the keyboard, use only the screen. So all the stuff is very, very popular. Let me show you in terms of a few scenarios here, right? So this is where probably you get to understand the breadth of offerings of Windows. Be it point of sale terminals, you might go to a supermarket and you check it out, your goods, the scan, your items you bought, everything is has a potential of Windows there. Now take digital signs, right? So in the airport, you might have a large screen display with some advertisements. What behind would be Windows. If you're looking at entertainment devices in flight, right? In the flight, you have small TVs. All the stuff is running Windows, right? So we call it industry internet. Yeah, it's a perfect. I would say you can summarize as you go along. But let me give an example of a few things. We have a product called Kinect, right? I spoke about natural user interface. I spoke about gesture-based interactions. So the Kinect is basically a companion to Xbox, which does skeletal tracking. Any movements I do, any hand movements I do, tracks it. Now, look at this scenario. This is healthcare, okay? Again, runs Windows. Now, this lady is actually performing physiotherapy on this gentleman, okay? Probably a leg ailment. Now, physiotherapy has to be done accurately, right? If you do it incorrectly, it will lead to aggravation of the particular wound or whatever ailment that person has. So it's very accurate. So now this person is monitoring, supervising physiotherapy using Kinect, right? Exact skeletal tracking. That's what scenario. Second, imagine you walk into a retail shop, okay? Now, by the way, this lady is trying out a few dresses. She's literally not wearing them. Okay? She's actually comes in her own clothes which is wearing, and she's not wearing new dresses. She can pick up a dress of her choice and actually see how she would look if she wore a bag. That's real good. It's absolutely real good. Okay? If you look at the background, I can say, you know what? Change the background. Because if it's a, let's say, a wedding for that matter, I mean, the background has to be a wedding setup. So I want to see how I look if I attend a wedding. Or if this is a beach, right? If I'm wearing a beach wear, I should know how I look if I wear this on real beach. Right? That's called the depth. Now, this is real. This is in the shop. This is called the depth tracking. By the way, today, if you buy a Kinect, you don't have to buy a Kinect. We have something called Kinect for Windows. Okay, that's a SDK available. In your academic curriculum, you can absolutely build this scenario. It's very real. So, the moment you stand in front of the screen, it will tell you, hey, what dress you want to wear today? You can say, choose your top, skirt, bangle, whatever it is, and it will show you exactly how you look if you wore that. Okay? Isn't it cool?
Yes.
Yeah? You walk into the shop and this is positive. No, you don't have to walk into the drive room, change, come back, something that choose. In Bangalore, it's very common. You know, it's basically crazy. It's almost like somebody's giving you free food. Right? There's a long queue in terms of changing there. So look at this. Today, we live in a world where 3D printers are very, very common. Have you heard of a 3D printer?
Yes, sir.
Yeah? Wonderful. Now, 3D printers is going to be probably as common as we have in one set at our house. Yeah? Imagine, so all of us, would have bought a printer. It's at home for printing purposes. But with the 3D printer being very commonly available today, today, going for an app on at home, and imagine, hey, you're going for, let's say, a birthday party, and you do not want a gift, but you have a model of, let's say, a car. Yeah? If you print it at home, you can print it, assemble it, gift it. That's possible. Now, this is called face recognition. Yeah? It's also called contest. If you want to print literally, one of the startups in Bangalore, that has the idea of, you know what, I want to make it the toys for children as easy as it can be. Imagine you go to the toy shop with your child, and you want to say, you know what, I want to buy this toy, but the face of this toy should be just like my daughter, or like my son. It's making it very personal. So they're using Kinect 3D capabilities, literally capture the child's face, contours, everything, and print it, attach it to the toy, and give it to them. That's the hyper-personalization. It's possible today. 3D printers and Kinect still be tracking. Okay? So, just to help you understand what is this internet, it's basically a marriage of mind and machine. We have a lot of ideas here. And there is a physical setup available. How can we literally, you know, wire them both? Yeah? Now, I'll give another example of industrial internet. It's called, you can take a preventive-based approach. Typically, if you look at, this is a real stat, by the way, I'm not just saying for the sake of saying, in the airline industry, billions of dollars are, I would say, wasted every year for preventive maintenance. It's basically happens as a reactive maintenance, but preventive maintenance could happen. If you do preventive maintenance, you'll literally save $25 billion every year. That's a lot of money, right? What does that mean? Imagine a flight encounters a slight technical snag in midair. Nothing to worry, it's basically a regular maintenance. But typically, how does it get recognized or diagnosed? It lands in a specific place, and for example, it lands in, let's say, Port Blair, and the technician gently does a maintenance check. If there's anything wrong, he fixes it, right? At times when they have to fix it, it amounts to delays, right? 1 hour, 2 hour delays, technical snag. Now imagine, if you have a chip inserted into that particular area, whichever machine that is, if that is, beaming information to basically the station saying, you know what, I need maintenance. There is something wrong with this operation. Moment it lands, make sure the technical team is ready so they can fix it before the departure time. Right? Typically, it's always discovered after it lands, and then the planned maintenance leads to the delays. So this is an example of industrial internet. Right? That means connected devices is generally everywhere. There's no boundary for that connected device. It can anywhere, and it can absolutely address preventive-based maintenance and all those aspects. And it's all about data, definitely. Right? How many of you use database system? How many of you use database system solutions, apps, applications? You know database, right? Database. Yeah? Something which shows information. Yeah? What database do you guys use? Can you name any database for me? Any database? Except you can. Yeah? Sorry? Oracle is one. What else? SQL. Somebody said Android operating system.
Excel.
Yeah? Excel. That can also be database, but generally, the multiple data sources. So we got data sources. End of the day, with all the devices that we have on this planet, it's an explosion of data as well. You need some repository. Right? Predictive maintenance also, imagine, I'll tell you one more example I'll give you here, just so, I have very few two slides left. I have a wonderful video to show as well. Maybe an example. Now, this is again healthcare, right? All of us go for health checkups frequently, right? Or infrequently, I would say. We might go once a year. But this company in Mumbai, they actually built in something called preventive health maintenance. That means they actually capture clinical data of yours, and they have data in terms of what is, they have a lot of patent data, and they'll actually predict if this person lives in southern part of India, specifically Bangalore, and his lifestyle is so-and-so, and his age is so-and-so, he'll probably get so-and-so type of diseases. Yeah? That means for the hospital, it's basically done for the hospital, if the hospital gives clinical data back to the clinical system, it tells you, hey, what's the next frequency by which this person will come back to for more checkups? Right? This person will encounter you know, heart-based diseases at 45. If he lives in Bangalore, eats rice all the time, blah, blah, blah. That's true, right? That's what we're heading towards. It's for preventive healthcare. Now, that's what is required going forward, right? We don't want to encounter them and then, hey, I got this diagnosis, something, you're going to face this in the future, so be ready for it or start fixing it. Be more health conscious, right? That's where the system is heading. To sum it up, I want to say, end of it as Microsoft, our vision is to create new experiences, right? End of, and also what matters is economic, right? It doesn't make sense if I say, you know what, buy HoloLens, it's going to cost $1 billion. Doesn't make any sense, nobody will buy it, right? So it's all economic. So I have a short video to show in terms of, you know, believe the world of wearing, it's again the world of physical and digital coming together, okay? We spoke about mind and mission. So physical and digital coming together, it's happening every single day. This video I'm going to show right now is real for sure. Some of it is research. It's real. It's happening as we speak. Cost is the only factor which is not making it generally seeable everywhere. Okay, cost is the factor which is probably not making it omnipresent. But a lot of stuff you see in the video is true, it's real, and it's happening. Let's take a look at this wonderful video.
In the next 5 to 10 years, the digital and physical will come together. Let's take a look at what this new world might be like. Work together in new ways, with interactive services that help you brainstorm, visualize projects, and simulate outcomes in real time. Bring your ideas to life naturally, and easily connect to the information and expertise you need. Work and create free. On whatever device you choose. Move the product review. Just like your refrigerator door, post pictures, share memories, and stay organized on your family wall.
Display doors around the house.
Unlike your fridge door, this works with all the devices and services in your home. Figuring out what's for dinner won't be a chore.
What can I make with this?
You explore new cuisines based on what you have on hand. And learn new techniques from your own virtual personal chef.
Hola, Julian here.
You'll still put your child to bed with a story. But just imagine if grandma could do that too. From far away. You'll create a story world.
No, a train. A train then.
And see your words come to life. All around the room.
Good night, Grandma. Good night, Grandma.
In the years ahead, technology will amplify our senses. Help us stay connected to people we care about. And transform the way we live, work, and play.
So, as I said, it's absolutely real. 90% is something which is we see it everywhere. 10% is the cost factor, which is probably necessary. So, now, this is my last slide. I want to tell you guys that, hey, there's a lot of different technology. You know, as Microsoft, we have hundreds of communities all over India. And in the island, if any of you want to start a community, okay, you can write to, you can go to technicommunity.com, that's a website address. And you can write to this lady, Usha Ratnabir, and she'll help you out. Okay? Now, is any community here? Do you guys form a small group? You invest in technology, you meet frequently, you can do that? Yeah? Is there a frequent meeting that you guys do once a month, talk technology, somebody comes and delivers sessions, you learn them? Does it happen at all? No? Okay. So this is an opportunity. If you want to start your own group, you can absolutely do that. And as Microsoft will help you out. Okay? With that, thank you so much. I think just my email address is what I put there, @microsoft.com, but you can note that my email is SWR. Anything, any questions you have going forward in terms of anything I spoke today or anything that you want to know from Microsoft, happy to respond to emails. Okay? Thank you so much and good luck with your attendance.
It was great listening to him. Unfortunately, he can't stay with us. So now we would like to call someone from Oracle, any manager, to continue.
It's not a part of the curriculum? Deploy those Java applications. You know, so SaaS applications are pre-built even to you, you are just a user of those applications. In a past model, if you are a technologist, you go into the next realm, which is actually building those applications, and a platform is given to host those applications, right? So that is what is PaaS. And finally, just to stay on that theme of cloud, the third piece of it is infrastructure as a service. So quite a lot of you may have heard of Amazon Web Services. How many of you here have heard of Amazon Web Services? Not Amazon.com, I'm talking about Amazon Web Services. Okay, so Amazon Web Services or Rackspace or Oracle in some parts of the world does IaaS, which is infrastructure as a service. And that is basically hardware. You know, there's no platform element to it, there's nothing to it. You just kind of have the hardware given, and on that piece of hardware, you can build and operate anything you want. You know, it can be Windows operating system on which you choose to put any IDE. You can build and operate anything you want. But that's, so those are the three layers that actually make up the cloud. Okay? And today's focus is going to be on two areas. One, I'm going to talk a little bit about how in platform as a service, you can build and host Java applications. And the second piece of it is how those Java applications can be extended to a mobile platform. Those are the two areas that I'm going to cover today. So initially, we'll start off by playing a video on a manufacturing application, how that manufacturing application was built and hosted on a platform, you know, to render a set of services. Let's have a look at this application, and then we can talk about this application and how it's built and the details of the application. We'll talk about in the coming slides. So let's go ahead.
By Oracle Technology, next generators, the Genrex 3000, AA Power Services Generators, PowerCo Usage Generators. Information from the Genrex 3000 is monitored via the Internet of Things platform. The Genrex 3000 shows an error. A notification is sent to AA Power. The error is a known issue based on a comprehensive historical record and knowledge base entry. While not common, the error is based on a faulty generator mount installation. The mount replacement is covered under the comprehensive warranty. The part is available in the existing inventory. Service is coordinated via the Oracle social network. The procedure for replacement is also part of a knowledge-based entry. Using the Oracle social network, collaboration with technicians guarantees the service appointment will go smoothly. Based on current products and contracts, a cloud recommendation engine suggests a new one for the customer. Using the software as a service platform, field service can become predictive instead of reactionary. NextGen can design a better generator mount or create a better installation procedure. AA Power can inquire to their customer base, verify enough replacement parts are available, and potentially upsell inspections and send out notifications. PowerCo can interface, describe, and document any issues that might have led out of the failure through social media, as well as purchase additional warranties. Everybody wins.
Space, you need to be aware that you know, maybe 20 years ago, I actually came out of college about 20 years ago, to now, the competition in IT landscape, you know, both in terms of technology innovations, the speed at which technology is getting innovated, to cost pressure. Like I said, about 15, 20 years ago, IT was cool. You know, I bought a computer or I got a laptop or something. It looked cool, but today enterprises are asking themselves a lot of questions around what cost, how much am I spending, those sort of questions. And all of that is giving rise to the cloud. And what is cloud? I mean, when you ask yourself, it is a consolidated pool of resources that are being used either internally or externally. And so that's what is driving the cloud. And here you can see the, you know, the percentage of adoption kind of tells you this. How much is the software as a service that I introduced as a concept earlier? What is the marketplace looking like? And platform as a service also is actually growing very rapidly. Okay? So, again, I mean, just in terms of numbers, so just telling you that cloud is a space that you need to give a lot of attention to. It's growing rapidly. You need to really look at it. Understand, I mean, there is quite a bit of it. I mean, cloud is a very large word. What I would suggest is there are very trivial or very preliminary content knowledge that is available out there on the web. So as you are reading information inside and outside of what is in your curriculum, what I would highly recommend and encourage you to do is read a lot about this, at least the technology, the jargon. Get yourself acclimatized to the concepts that are available in and around this space. Okay? And so, the benefits in terms of cloud, I spoke about how, you know, you consolidate a pool, you actually, you know, it's bringing together of resources, whether it's within one company's network or it's a, you know, it's a global or a public cloud, as they call it. So within cloud, you've got the next level of thing is a public cloud and a private cloud. A private cloud is typically hosted by somebody. It could be an Airtel, you know, hosting a private cloud for themselves, where they are trying to reduce the technology sprawl, you know, bringing together a lot of machines, understanding what their utilization is, and optimizing that infrastructure that they have so that they can reduce cost of their expense to keep that infrastructure all up and running and manageable. The second piece of it is a public cloud. Okay? So these are the two clouds that are available out there. Right, and both of them bringing different kinds of benefits, different kind of benefits to these three. These are the three audiences that we are trying to address. You know, I would primarily, at least initially, see yourself in one or two. You know, where the developer community, us. You know, the first question you ask yourself is, okay, there is cloud. You know, okay, but what am I going to benefit from this? So what is in it for you from a private, from a cloud perspective? I, as a developer, let's say for example, I choose to use, I think the previous gentleman had talked about databases, you know, and let's say you choose to use Java as a platform. You choose to use application servers or various, you know, components within that what is available to be able to build an application or build a project that you want to do, you need a set of components to be able to do that. Okay? So then the question becomes, do I need specific hardware for it? Okay? Do I need specific hardware for it? Because if I bought, if each one of you sitting in this room here bought separate hardware to build applications on that particular platform, it's going to be so expensive. Right? So what do? You go to the cloud. You know, you go to the cloud. So first, cost. Second piece of it for the developer, right? There is a series of best practices that have been adopted by several people on the cloud. There is a series of best practices. If I need to code in Java, I need to do this, A, B, C, D, E, to be able to accomplish my objective in the best possible manner. So, how do I imbibe that? I need to have a common place to go to. Maybe a source code repository, a set of practices. You know, if I'm, let's say, 3-4 of you are together working on a particular project, how can I have a common place where we go and log our activity, somebody is monitoring that activity, assigning tasks, all of that is what is in it for a developer. The second piece or the second community or the audience that we try to address is operations, right? Again, operations, first thing, you know, the same thing would apply to a developer also. The first thing that we look at when we look at operations is your standardization, right? You standardize everything across the spectrum. One, from an operations perspective, you are able to see that I have found the applications that I've been running, out of which these applications are using this amount of space and are being, or space or resources, and are being used by X number of users, giving this benefit to my organization. You know, a lot of you may be surprised here if I told you this. A very large multinational bank, a US-based bank, was just doing an audit of the applications they had and figured that they had about 3,000 applications which